Hi Katharina,
Hello.
hi Michael. Michael, sorry.
Hello,
Katharina, can you introduce yourself and introduce Michael?
of course. Hi, if you don't remember me, you have a chance because I was in program committee of HolyJS 2 years ago, and now I'm in Tel Aviv, so but still with HolyJS conference. And I want to introduce our speaker, Michael Hladky from Vienna, Austria. Hi, Michael.
Hello, hello. Happy to be here.
How are you?
I'm good. The only downside here in Vienna, it started to get really cold and I'm freezing all the
How much cold?
Much cold. Too cold for me. I have no clue. It's plus something, but it's too cold.
Yeah,
I need
have same
Tel Aviv
problem.
temperature. But in
Oh,
Tel
okay.
Aviv, it's still a better temperature than here, I would say.
Yeah, but it's raining awfully. Like, very, like, don't recommend at all. Okay, I'm nervous. Like, is it your first talk for the like non-English speaking audience?
For non-speaking audience, not because I'm pretty often at NG China and other countries which are not that fluent in English. But it is my first one at HolyJS, and for me it is really a big achievement. I tried it a couple of times so far, and the talks need to be really hardcore. I heard people say to get in HolyJS, so I'm really glad I made it this time, and I hope I can give some hardcore knowledge.
Yeah, like I know we like hardcore talks in Russia.
I heard
Okay, let's try to check if it's true or not. So I know that we can hear you, people who watch this talk, but applause for our speaker, Mikhail Hladky, with his talk. And Mikhail wanted me to mention that he's the karaoke star. And let's check if he would prove this in this talk. So let's start.
Thanks, Ekaterina. Okay. Let's start with my talk, Fully Zoneless High Performance Rendering in PostIV. And I have to admit something at the very beginning. It's not zone-less, it is zone-agnostic. So all the stuff that I show you work in any Angular application, no matter if you use zone and you don't use zone. It is just the way how we do stuff under the hood. So this is a first clarification on the talk title. Let's see what we will discuss. I will talk a little bit about a design document, a quite old design document from the Angular team. I will mention something about state management. This was a big research that I did 1.5 years ago. I will talk about rendering. I will talk about the internals of how Angular will render all the stuff. And then I will talk about template helpers. Template helpers that help you to introduce really cool ergonomic code styles where you don't have to clutter your HTML with a lot of wrapper container. I will talk about techniques where you can do, for example, under the fold optimization or even at runtime where you can just stop a particular part of your app from getting re-rendered if it is not visible on the view right now. I will show you how to trick Zone.js and what the best trick is to do that, and then I will present upcoming features, and especially for HolyJS, because it has to be super hardcore and not recorded and completely new information and whatever, I put it a lot of time in cool demos that I can show you about all the upcoming features, about my current research on scheduling, on performance insights, and this will be the last three sections here on the menu, Rx, if, and switch. Then the particular cool stuff on RX4, a new directive that we are working on, and then, of course, the most exciting stuff, main threads scheduling. Let's start. Let's start with the design document from Mishko about change detection mental model in Ivy. And there were also a couple of previous design documents which were more or less focusing on the same topics. And let me just walk you a little bit through this design document, so that you can get a clue why I'm so interested in following this idea since 2 years now. So, and new stuff, this is really something that shipped with Ivy, is Mark Doherty. And the information on zone exchange detection is quite, let's say it's not good present at the moment. People just started to dig into these new abilities. And one of them is Mark Doherty. Mark Doherty has some cool tricks where you can detect changes in your application without zone. It has a couple of things where you can introduce scheduling and coalescing, and it has a callback after render callback hook. This is pretty exciting, and I took over this idea and moved it from the global level to the local level and introduced similar concepts on a component level. On the component level, we have new structures from Ivy. We have L containers and LFUs. This is the hidden HTML, the hidden structure that Ivy produces to render our HTML. There were a couple of sections about elements. Angular elements are like web components. They are web components. And for web components, especially change detection and zone was a big problem in the past. This is also something that could be fixed or that they are working on in the future to make it a little bit more easy based on that design document. We have significant performance benefits if we do that, if we run our change detection locally. This is something I will demo a lot in this presentation. And of course, this had a stepping stone to do all of that in Angular is explicit state management. So you will also get an introduction into my research on state management. My name is Michael Latke. I'm a trainer and consultant. I do a lot of work regarding Angular and especially in the web. In the last time, I focused on performance audits, and how to get your application up to speed. I spent, as I said, a couple of years now on that topics, and in the last half year, I started to like expose more and more of my work and ship it as open source library. So let's start and talk about reactive component state. This was one of my researches I did last year, and I presented it at the end of last year. A really cool presentation. I was very pleased to get to keynote NGPE. NGPE is my most favorite conference. I cannot talk a lot of that much about it, too much. Back to the talk. The state management stuff. It helped me to get from a very confused data flow where we had like synchronous, asynchronous things flying around in the application to a very structured one. So as you can see in the middle, there is a lot of structure. There is a lot of order in this image here. And then in the next step, I move it to a very performant way of handling, connecting our state, and especially ergonomic. I solved a couple of problems. I want to quickly talk about subscription handling with component providers. So on the left side, you have a service, and this service takes over the subscription handling. Subscription handling is most annoying in pretty much everywhere you use RxJS. So I solved it by, if you look on the other side to the component, I solved it by moving the subscription handling, the subscribe and unsubscribe based on the lifecycle hooks on ng on destroy in this case, into a service and used this service in my component. So this service is doing all the work, and this is a very abstract and low level way. You will later on see that this is hidden under the hood, but just that you can get a clue what problems I solved to ship this state management stuff. A second problem was composition should be hot. Otherwise we will lose values. And this is a very, very quick intro in the problem. If we use share replay and we just replay the last value, the moment of subscription will determine the moment of composition, and so we could lose values. And this was also one of the main things that I solved in the research, also known as late subscriber problem. And I solved it to move the control the moment of subscription to the provider side, and all the composition is hot always, no matter if the template subscribes to it or not. And the last one, and I guess the most beneficial one here, subscription-less interaction. Another concept that I introduced, and if you take a look at this slide here, this is a very simple state management. We have a subject that we can next a value into it with a function that is called setState. You see that on the left side. And on the right side, you see the default stuff that we have to do over and over again, subscribe to it, use a take until. The lifecycle hook is even not possible, not displayed here, so there would be even more code. And then you can connect those things to your state. This is a marble diagram that you see here that shows you where the problem is. This line here, this purple line, is an interruption of your reactive coding style. You stop it, you subscribe to it, you call set state on or set or next on a subject. And this is the way how you connect different observables together. This was the main problem and clutter in all Angular applications. And what I did is I introduced subscription-less interaction. I said, okay, if I have all my observables present, why could I just use the subject that I next into it as a higher order observable, as an observable of observables? And then I could just use the merge all operator and do all the subscription handling under the hood. As you can see, the complexity of this stuff is lowered a lot. And if we see it all together, you see there is no cut, no edge, and we have this just forwarding a full observable into your state management, and it will connect automatically. These are some principles that I worked on, some problems that I solved and that I implemented. Here you see the outcome is on the right side, a one-liner for every single observable you want to connect to your state. This is when I mentioned ergonomics. So the whole ergonomic part also took a lot of focus on how easy it is for user to either connect to an observable or render it to the template. And so far we did a good job. The outcome was rxangular/state. It has the public API of a upper and a lower level. We can have connect and select where we work with observables reactively. We take an observable and we directly connect it to the state, as I showed before. And we have also the select method where we can select a stream of state changes. If you like to code imperative, or especially if you need to glue together your reactive state management to your Angular component, or any other component in other frameworks, you would use setter, set state, get state. I guess this is a concept very familiar, and this is called imperative programming. Then I also introduced hold. Hold is a method to just hold a subscription to a side effect, and this side effect is not interfering or is not introducing any state change. The typing here, just as a quick overview, also very ergonomic, very symmetric, as you can see. And overloads help us to solve all the problems. We have three ways to connect observables. Here we have a small reducer function that could take the old state and the new one. And of course, we have the same for our imperative method, the set. Hold is here to hold a subscription. As I said, this subscription handling here with hold is just here to subscribe to a side effect that is not taking place on any state changes. On the other hand, we have selections. We can select state or we can get state imperatively. I guess this concept is pretty clear. And here just a quick point out on the first method overload. As you can see, instead of using functions, we could also use a shortcut and provide the property name directly. If we use that, we see that we can reduce the code of our application a lot and only focus on the stuff that is really, really relevant. Let me quickly show you how cool subscription-less interaction is by opening up my code here. And I quickly open up this this component. We have a title, we have a list, and we have a refresh button. I will zoom in that you can see it better. And I will introduce my state here. I could do it by extending my class here with RxState, or I could also inject it. And I can type my state with component state. So this is the way how I introduced or made my component reactive. I could also use it as local provider. As you remember, maybe I said there is a trick with local providers. So this time, let me move it into the local providers and it would also work. I could delete it here. So those are the two things that I need to do to introduce my state. Now I can use it here as a property, call it state, and I can now work with that state in my application. My state is fully typed, so I could say, why not introduce an initial state? Initial state is not always the best because it prevents of being lazy in our template and having lazy rendering, but in some cases it helps. So I could introduce my state with an initial set of properties. This is how I use it to initialize it. And I could also use this set method here to connect my input binding to the state. On this very place here, I could say I receive a variable called refresh interval, and I could set this variable here and add it. All those things are pretty cool to do with state. And the last thing, how I can demonstrate the other way how we could connect and work really subscription-less, is I could show you how to connect global state management. Here we have our list service. You can imagine this is some Redux state management or something else. And this provides me with an observable of list items, as you can see here, list dollar. And what I want to do is I want to connect this list dollar to our state property. Let's take a look at the typing and the interface of our state. Here we see we have our refresh interval and the list. So the property is named list, and I want to connect to that property. I scroll down, I name the property that I want to connect to, and I can directly connect this observable and all its output with my state management and use it directly in the template. This is just a quick insight. There are a couple of overloads. You don't need to work with strings. You can all do with functions, but just that you can get a quick overview and insights in what I did with state management. If you want to need more information, if you want to get the latest and greatest, you can take a look at the demo here at the documentation at rxangular-docs on bit.ly. But now let's switch to the main topic and to the really exciting stuff, to Angular rendering. And I want to start with a punchline. I want to say the async pipe is boring, and I want to convince you that the async pipe is boring, and I promise after this talk you will agree. But first, let's understand how Angular is rendering our templates. If we speak about rendering in Angular, we always think in component trees or in tree structures. And this is a mockup of a to-do list with the application ref as a service at the top, and then my menu items and my list items. And if I turn this into a component tree, it looks like that. Every component has a parent and a child beside the app component. Angular is rendering this, and if I call application ref tick, Angular goes from the very top to bottom and renders the very component, its children, and in turn its children, until it is done with the full tree. As this is a lot of work and pretty imperformant, we could do something better. Angular introduced something that's called change detection on push. Let me quickly introduce you to that. So if I call change detection, if I call application ref tick, I went down this tree, and this very component with the triangle, with the light gray triangle, turned into a dark gray triangle. The triangle is a symbol for change detection on push. Change detection on push checks if the previous value is different from the current value. So if there is a diff, if there is a delta. In this case, there is no delta, there is no change. So we stop re-rendering that part and we re-render only the part that is needed. And this is pretty cool. And a lot of people are really excited and they say, this is the solution for our performance problems. We just put the async pipe and on push strategy everywhere and we solved our problems. Unfortunately, not. So if we want to introduce a change to this very component here, and we want to update and render it, we maybe, because there is the chance that we forget to introduce change detection on push, we maybe re-render unnecessary components. You can say, I will introduce a linting rule. I will really make sure that I cannot ship code where I don't use change detection on push. But even then, you use third-party libraries and so on and so forth. If you say, I write all my code on my own, you still will end up with a problem. Look at that. If I introduce a change into this purple component here, I have to go up the full component tree, mark every component as dirty, and re-evaluate all those components again and again and again. And now imagine you have a function in this tree here that is called in the template. This function will get re-evaluated again, will maybe re-render something in the template. So it takes a lot of time, a lot of effort for the browser to do all that work. And this is the main cause of our performance problems. So how to fix that performance problem? First of all, let me demonstrate that there really is over-rendering. And I will demonstrate it by displaying a component structure, a nested component structure, where we have our components here, and there is default, and there is on push. So this is the change detection strategy that this component live on. And if I turn on the ripple effect here, and I, for example, click application ref tick from the very top to the very bottom, you see components re-render, and it really stops at on push. So this very component here, and also the on push components, they do not get re-rendered because we have this very cool ability of change detection on push. So now imagine you would use the async pipe. You would use the async pipe at this very component here. The async pipe under the hood uses MarkDirty. If I click this MarkDirty button here, you will see what I re-render. If I click this MarkDirty button, I have to re-render the full path of all components that are on this way up to the top. This is really a clutter, and there are way cooler ways to do that. Let me just demonstrate that even MarkDirty from Ivy also does the same. It is zone less, so it does not really depend on zone, but as you can see on the flashing numbers, it really re-evaluates and re-renders the whole application. And this is a clutter. This makes our application slow. What we can try to do is we could introduce local change detection with change detection detect changes. And this is what I want to start to introduce in the next couple of minutes here. Let me quickly full screen it again. Okay, so in the section rendering, we also shipped an open source library, the second one out of a few upcoming, that is called rxangular/template. rxangular/template shipped already a couple of features that you can see here, and I want to start and focus with two of them, the push pipe and the rxlet directive. So the push pipe here, you can see at the top, is a replacement for the async pipe. What it will do is, it will only re-render the very component that you use. Under the hood, by default, it uses detect changes to introduce this change on a very local level. So all this rendering is done with the principle of locality in mind. And the second directive that I created is rxlet. rxlet is a structural directive that takes an observable and binds this observable to this very snippet of HTML here and updates whenever the value changes. So how can I demonstrate this? I can maybe quickly start with a very, very prominent example, I could use the ng-if hack with an observable with the async pipe here to display values in my component. And if you think about that, a lot of people do it because they want to bind this very observable and use it multiple times in their template snippet so that they don't have to use the async pipe everywhere. This is the main reason. And what RxLet is doing is it helps you to get rid of this bullish behavior. Why is this a problem? Because if I go here to template RxLet RxIfHack, here we go. So if you look at this very part here and I next the value, you see that only truthy values are visible. I scroll a little bit down and you can see only true is visible, no false values. Same goes for the push pipe. Here you see we re-render everything with the push pipe. We can re-render only this very component, but still only the true values are visible. Not if you take a look at the RxLet directive. And let me now show you how to introduce that so we can basically replace the whole snippet here with RxLet. And here I just put the observable, let me create a value here, and then I can display it. I can display it, and this very snippet here will not render, it will not take energy of the browser to render it before the first value enters this very component. And this is the first time where Angular really saw laziness in the template. This is how you can introduce laziness into a template by not rendering something if there was no emission yet. And you can say, okay, if I don't render it, in some cases, I still want to render something. Maybe I want to render a state of the suspend state or something else. So I could start to introduce templates. I could say, use these three local variables here and I assign templates that are present at the very top here that I quickly want to make visible. And those templates are templates for three different states. For the suspend state, the next state, for the suspense, the error, and the complete state. And if I do that, I'm able to basically render a loading spinner here. If there is an error, I could render the error, and if my process is completed, I can also signal the user, this is completed, there will be no other updates on this part. And if I click in my demo and I look at the very right here, RxLet, I can do it, we also have it implemented here. This is my loading spinner, and only if I click next, I will introduce the stuff and I render the value and as you can see, also false values are present. And I could also click the error, or I could click after I next the complete button. And you see, I can use different templates to handle all my reactive states. This is a really cool thing. And we have a couple of other things in the queue that we will release in the future. For example, template triggers. But that's enough. Let's go back to the really interesting stuff. Let's go to rendering strategies. So rendering strategies is like the coolest and best part on our library. Why? Because with rendering strategies, we are able to partially introduce very specific techniques to your rendering. We could distinguish different parts from each other, prioritize them differently, and so on and so forth. And you can use strategies by applying a colon and then the strategy name here, or you can do the same with the RxLet directive. The first strategy that I want to talk about is the global strategy, and this helps us to finally get zone-free change detection on a global level, on the app level. So as you saw before, when I introduce a change, I will go up the tree and mark everything as dirty and then re-render it again. The problem is I still re-render a lot of components, and this is not really optimal. So let's demo this, and let me again demonstrate that this strategy is already working. I can go back and I can click on concepts, and under concepts I again have this nested strategy. So here, if I click, if I turn on the ripple, of course, and if I click the button, you see that it works on less, but it re-renders the full application. So what can we do against that? We can say we switch to local, the principle of locality in your Angular component. Under the hood, we use change detection, detect changes. So this method here, there is one that shipped with Ivy in green, but there were always cdref.detect changes. So this method is nothing new to Angular. It was here from the very beginning. And if we introduce a change to this component with that strategy, as you can see, we don't go up and down and re-render the full tree. We really only render the stuff that is present here. How did we do that? So you would say, well, it's super easy, just introduce detect changes there. You will end up in re-rendering your application 12 times, and or in this example 12 times, you will at least end up in over-rendering your application. And to solve this, I introduce you to two different principles, scheduling and coalescing. Let's start with scheduling. So scheduling, if you look at the browser, you can in best get a clue of what scheduling is by looking at flame charts. And flame charts have scripting work and rendering work, right? And this is rendering work. We have layouting, updating the trees, compositioning of this stuff, and then painting all that stuff. And this very green line here is right before the paint event happens. So there are events in our application, for example, a click handler that is a click listener that if you click that button calls a function, triggers a function call. And this event basically triggers logic or trigger logic. This logic here will execute a specific snippet of code. In our example, the specific snippet of code is down here, work. Work, I named it XXX as function name that we easily can spot it in the flame charts. And this is what work does. It just updates with detect changes the particular view. So what is scheduling? What is scheduling a task? Scheduling a task means that some event introduces or calls this trigger logic, and this trigger schedules a snippet of code to a different part of your browser event loop, and there over some events, for example the animation frame here, it executes the work. This is essentially what scheduling is. And we used scheduling as a technique to introduce a couple of different cool tricks. To give you a slight intro how many different options you have with scheduling, take a look at that flame chart here. I fired everything possible at one place, and you see how distributed the execution of all those functions is. A really, really interesting topic that we want to dive in deeper in the next slides. And I want to dive deeper by talking about coalescing. So what is coalescing? Coalescing means that I will use a time frame to buffer values together, and after this time frame, I will forward it only one time. This reduces the number of executions of something, work. So the time frame in this case is a microtask. A microtask is synchronous code. It is executed after the synchronous code. I call it nearly synchronous code, but it is after all the synchronous code is done. And if I forward a lot of renderings, I could say I forward all those renderings to a function. And this function is starting when the first value enters and then starts a microtask. And only after this microtask is done, it takes all the collected values and forwards it only one time in this very browser event loop tick. And this is what we did, or how we implemented coalescing. We can call it infinite times, in this case here three times, by scheduling this function and then displaying or rendering the stuff afterwards only one time. So this is the first trick we introduced. And the second thing that we did is we introduced rendering over the animation frame, and then we also went down. Let me show you what coalescing does to our component. And I switch to another demo here that is called coalescing. And I switch to the Angular default way of doing it. And if I would click this button here one time, you can count the numbers. This here is 10. And if I click the button, it jumps up 9 times. Another click 9 times, another click 9 times. So we see our application is not re-rendered, but this very component is re-rendered 9 times. So we introduce coalescing to this setup, and I click the button, and it is only re-rendered, as you can count the number, 3 times. The problem here is that we are able to coalesce all the values for each pipe, but there is no way to detect how many pipes you have and if all those pipes will fire for the same time. And this is where we brought in scoped coalescing. Scoped coalescing is basically a trick how to introduce a scope to your coalescing so that you not only have the time as buffer, as range, but also multiple participants on that time frame, multiple components. And in that way, we improved by using detect changes the number of components that get change detected. With coalescing, we went down to 4, and with scoped coalescing to 1 re-rendering for this particular example. And then we used the animation frame to have an efficient rendering, a rendering that is really on the right spot and does not demand too much of your browser. So you will have a snappy and fluid feeling in your app. This is a pretty exciting, and we did a lot of stuff with all those things. I don't want to click too much around in this presentation and show you other stuff. I quickly want to introduce you to a way how you can handle a form, for example. We have a loading spinner. We can display the loading spinner. We can update the form, introduce new values. And if we produce an error, for example, we could also handle this error state. So this is RxLab, again, already with coalescing and scheduling in place. What we can also do is we can preload images, we can preload components. So if you take a look on my loading spinner here, if I click the button, I lazily loaded a component. I did code splitting on component level with just one line of code here. This is also a really cool thing that you can do with the LET directive. And this focuses on a lot of stuff related to ergonomics and just getting rid of this first batch of over-rendering so that you can really have the most performant things in your application. Another stuff that we did, and I'm not sure if there is a proper demo here, is we did a lot of tricking Zone.js. So if you see here, when I click this set timeout button, we only re-render this very component. And if you would do it in a normal Angular application, the component would also trigger a re-evaluation of the full application. So how we did that, or how people try to avoid, for example, button clicks re-rendering the full application. How did we trick Zone? So we shipped a directive that is called unpatch. And this unpatch directive basically reduces the amount of work. If we take a look at this very slide here, we see this is a Hello World example with just the button inside, nothing else. If I click the button one single time, this is what our browser does. We could introduce over some tricks a way to run this code outside of Angular. So we use ng-zone, inject it, and call its outside of Angular method to run this particular code. And you see, we would go down to a fifth of all the work. This is already amazing. But now let's take a look what we did with RxAngular. We claim to be a zone agnostic library, so we don't introduce ng-zone or some other helper services anywhere. Our code looks like that. This is really vanilla JavaScript. As little as possible code you can execute and the fastest possible thing to get rid of unwanted zone evaluations in a zoneful application. Pretty cool. There is also viewport priority that I want to demo quickly. This is now a little insight on how we can start to do under the fold optimizations. So if you have something in the viewport that takes time to render, of course you want to render it. And here I click on automatically update. So this is now ticking and our view is updated every second. But what if this very component is not visible? Rendering should stop. And we can prove it because if you look at this very number here, it is basically the same number as here. And when I scroll out of the viewport, you see that this number stops ticking. So this is a very cool way to do under the fold optimization initially, but also later on. A really, really cool part, maybe the coolest part that we are working on at the moment, are our new directives and new ways on using strategies, render strategies. I already presented the push pipe and the let directive. There is also Rx if, Rx switch, Rx match, Rx for, a couple of things we are working on, and the most excited one is the Rx for one. But before I go that way, let me get another level deeper in our component tree. You remember that a component tree is hanging with the app component on the application ref and everywhere components. And our strategies and our rendering went down from a component tree to a single component. But if we take a closer look to one single component, inside of this component, there is a structure built out of L containers and L views. Those ivy building blocks that I showed at the very beginning. So we can think of a component tree now, of a tree of components, where every component in turn has a view tree. A view tree of even smaller pieces, L container and L view. And at the moment, we are working on getting to the next level and triggering change detection only on the pieces that are really needed. Let me demonstrate our experiments here. This is not released yet. I just want to demonstrate what we are working on. It is pretty far. We just need to do last refactorings to release the stable version. So this is detect changes. You see that I re-render not the application, but this very component. All pieces in my component are re-rendered. And this is because I call change detector ref detect changes. So structural directives have something inside that is called embedded view. And embedded view is a smaller piece of HTML, which in turn consists out of those L view and L containers. And if I would be able to trigger the change detection only on those embedded views, and this is what I do with the button click here, take a look at the numbers. I really only re-render the very snippet of HTML that is needed. Amazing and really, really cool. And this works for RxIF. So here we have different demos on how to hide and show the RxIF stuff. And when we were researching that, we realized that Angular is trashing our template. So if we look at this number here, we see that this is always one when I switch to true or false. And if we take a look at this number here, this is what we are doing at the moment with template caching, we see this number increases all the time. So instead of doing the same stuff as Angular does and throwing away the template that we hide at the moment and recreate it again when we show it, we said, okay, we introduced template caching. We introduce template caching, or maybe you could also think about object pooling, which is a particular technique that is also well known and is very similar. And I want to just demonstrate quickly how cool the performance optimizations are. And I do this by zooming into another demo here. And the very left one is a template structure that displays 1,000 items, and when I toggle it, it renders it, and when I toggle it again, it hides it. And on this very side here, we do the same stuff, but we just used template caching. So let me demonstrate what shows when I click this button and toggle this thing a couple of times. And then I stop recording and switch to, and refresh this page, and switch to the optimized version where we use template caching and do another recording. And show and hide and show and hide. And here there is a bug. And I have a bug in my live demo. But what we should see is that repainting all the numbers. No, I don't have a bug. I just didn't saw it. Okay, here we go. I'm happy. So I can show you. This is re-rendering every single click. Let me measure it quickly for you. We have a 440 milliseconds and a lot of frame drops. If I switch to the optimized version, we have this stuff only at the first time. If we take a look at other updates and I zoom in a little bit, we are down to 120 milliseconds. And this is only the beginning. So you can see template caching brings a lot of benefit and you can get way faster rendering. But let me go to one of the cooler things. We ship RX4, and RX4 is known, or nested structures in the template are known as most imperformant. And I will do another measurement for you. I will record quickly how Angular performs if we introduce 10 items and update those 10 items as fast as we can. And these 10 items have 3 different child items in it. And I will do the same thing for our new feature, the RX4 directive. I will use track by, I will use distinct by, a new thing that we introduced, and I will run the same measurement again. And I will do the recording now. And now I record, and after a couple of seconds, I stop it, and I wait until we see the flame charts here. And as you can see in the second version, this is what you see here. Let me zoom out. You have not a single frame drop. And in the first version, what Angular does by default, you have only blocking frames and you have a lot of recalculation, a lot of rechecking. So this is like one of our things where we really can prove that our work pays off. But now let me get to the most exciting stuff and to the final demonstration in this very presentation. You don't know all the cool tricks that we are working on. You see how much more performant this could be in your application. Now let me talk a little bit about the stuff that nobody ever heard before in my presentations. Since the very beginning, since the very first day of when we started this project, we worked on a topic called main thread scheduling. You maybe know it from Post-Task Scheduler, a new tool that will ship in Canary Chrome, or you maybe heard about React Concurrent Mode. All those things are related to main thread scheduling. All the things do main thread scheduling. And what is main thread scheduling, or what is the problem of main thread scheduling? If you take a look at this very chart here, I click a button and then I update 100 items. In this case, I remember it was 500. And this is what happens normally. I click the button and immediately, or let's say after a micro task, when we do this small coalescing feature, we directly render it and it really blocks the screen. And this is a several milliseconds, nearly a second, where nothing can be moved or done in the screen. And you can say, okay, this is pretty cool. And we could, with a very simple idea, take every single emission and schedule every single emission on a, let's say, timeout. And then we would tick the timeout, and you can see that a lot of frames are needed, a lot of repaints. And it is better because it is not that much blocking. You can do stuff in between. The browser will react, but busy, a lot of stuff. We could also do that with other techniques. So the first technique was buffering every 10 items. This technique is scheduling everything on an animation frame and doing 10 items. But as you can see, the work is not getting less, and it really takes a lot of time and a lot of executions for just updating 500 items. So what we did is we introduced main thread scheduling, and main thread scheduling does something really, really interesting. First of all, look that the frames that are taken here are less. The time is reduced to nearly a fifth of the stuff that we were taken before. And all those small fractions are in a different size. So what is main thread scheduling? You say, I have packages of work. These packages of work, I make them as small as possible. I send to a global queue. And this global queue collects all those little pieces of work and starts to execute them. And when it starts to execute all those little pieces of work, it measures how long am I executing already. And when it takes too long, and when it measures that it takes more than, let's say, 50 milliseconds, when it takes more, when it could get close to a frame drop, then it starts to stop, execute, and reschedule the stuff again. And do the other stuff, the other work, in the next frame. And again, the other stuff in the next frame. So we are sure, no matter how heavy, how much of this work is present in our browser, we will never block. And I want to demonstrate this to you now. So let me scroll to performance. And all the screenshots I did with this very example here, I just put it 500 items, and then I re-rendered 500 items. And I can do it statically, and I could re-render all at once. It will not change with the async pipe. It will change a little bit with the push pipe, because we only render the very component and not everything. But this did not really chunk up the work. So we started to think about this progressive style of doing stuff, where you see it really gets in piece by piece. In our case, we chunk it by 100 items, but not really the best one. So we switched in the very last example to a technique where we measure the time. And now let me show you how it feels, how it looks if we use this technique, for example, that React is using now. Now, public audience is seeing for the first time main thread scheduling and how I ported Angular's React concurrent mode into Angular, or how we ported it, the whole team of RX Angular. So as you can see, it is way faster than before. And if I click it very fast, you can see I can stop in between the rendering. And this stopping is very important to have non-blocking screens. And I can compare all those strategies. I can say, show me all different ways how we can prioritize scheduling and run them all together. And if I introduce the change, you see there is an order. Even if they are executed left to right, the rendering goes right to left, just as a quick intro. But I guess this intro does not tell you a lot. So I was spending a lot of time on how I can really visualize main thread scheduling, how I can visualize that parts of your component have more priority than other parts of your application. If you think about like a button click and a tooltip should be with a higher priority rendered than some background HTTP fetching or whatever. So I came up with a demo that I call pixel priority. I have a couple of PNG images here, and every single pixel in this PNG image has a color. There are transparent colors, there are dark colors, and there are light colors. And then I take this image and I move it into a canvas and measure the color of every single pixel. And I do this by clicking on this little Mario here. Let me quickly increase the pixel size and zoom in a little bit. So these are all colors in the Mario, and this here is transparent, lowest priority 5, then we have black, highest priority, and then we have the colors. If I click on render, you see that all those components appear in a different order. So they have priorities. First the black, then brown, red, then this pink, bluish, and at the very end, the transparent stuff. I have a couple of different things here that I could click and re-render, and I'm really addicted. Sometimes I sit like hours in front of the computer and re-render this stuff. But let me demonstrate how you can really see the priority. I click on this, whatever it is, monster here, and it has, I guess, 9,500 items. Let me reduce the size of the pixels a little bit. And let me close this so that you can see it. Okay, we can go a little bit more. Last demo, I promise. I have still 1 minute left. So those are really components. And if you don't believe me, I can hover over every single one of these components. And if I click the button, first, all the ones are scheduled, then the seconds, then the thirds, then the fourths, and then all transparent colors. And in between, I'm able to interrupt this process and prove that it is non-blocking. I click the button now. First, the black colors turn into red, then the lighter colors, then the really light colors, and at the very end, only at the very end, the transparent colors. And if I click it again, you see only the black colors appear first, then the darker colors, the next layer of darker colors, and then all transparent colors. And I could click this button after another and really stop and start it over and over again. Let me switch to another cool one here. Let me switch to this Bowser. Let me close the various section here. And wait until it is processed. This is also a very big image, an image with 3,900 components. If I click it very fast, you see that I can interrupt while this drawing is ongoing, and right in the middle, in whatever priority I am, I can just stop and start again. And this was one of the last the last demo that I want to demonstrate today. You saw everything that nobody knew before, and now I have a lot of work because people will ping me and tell me when it is ready, when it is ready. I will promise it is ready soon. As you can see, it runs already very stable, but as we have out the beta version at the moment, this is the last chance to make final changes on the public API. So we will introduce these final changes. Don't break you, and then in a very near future, you can install this over NPM and enjoy the full performance and all new features. So let's ramp it up. Let me say thanks, a big thanks to all contributors, to all people interested in contributing in this library. If you want to cheer us up, give us a star on GitHub. We really enjoy getting started on GitHub. If you're interested in the library, again here at rxangular/template or at rxangular/state. And that's it. This is the very end. And I have to say thanks for your time. And thanks for listening, for spending nearly 60 minutes of your precious time with my presentation. Thanks a lot. This is the end of the presentation. You are muted. You are muted. No problem. We have time, and in between, while you're trying to unmute yourself, I will try to fill it. Ah, the screen switch. Now I have audio.
Yeah. We have little problem with sound from Ekaterina. And thank for your talk. 1 second. I find my question for you. yeah. One second. Where is? Yeah. My question for you. What do you? Ekaterina.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
We can hear you.
Okay. So.
Amazing.
Sorry.
So glad to
sorry,
hear you.
Misha. No questions from you today.
Yes.
I have my questions. Okay. So the first one is the obvious, because like everything that you presented is super shiny thing. So the question is, did you do the pull request to Angular, and like, can it become the part of the Angular? Because like, sounds very cool. And before you start answering, sorry, if anyone is here and want to ask a question, don't hesitate to do it in the Telegram channel, even in Russian. We can translate it. Okay, sorry.
Yeah, yeah, I can
answer.
Translate. Yeah, the question is if I file the pull request and if it will ship to Angular. I guess most of the stuff not, because the reactive templates, like the structural directives, they are working a lot with observables. Of course, they also work with promises, with generics and generators and so on, but Angular will, I guess, not introduce more reactive features, because they have to support more documentation, right? The imperative documentation, the reactive documentation, and so on. So I guess this is one of the reasons why they will not ship more reactive stuff. What I'm pretty sure that they will do is that they will work also on main thread scheduling, and they will work on how to configure MarkDirty. MarkDirty takes an object. This is something that we turned into a strategy. So we do a little bit more than handing over the priority. We also detect if we have like templates to update and so on and so forth. But in general, I guess this topic could have potential that I can contribute some knowledge, some design documents, some outcome of my research to the team, to the Angular team. We have not regular, but from time to time we talk about that stuff, and I demo the new findings and I ask new questions. How can I solve this and that tricky problem? And yeah, so there is a discussion, but I'm at least for now I'm pretty sure that most of the stuff will not land. But it's not that bad, because everybody can download it directly from NPM, and it is fully unit tested, fully tested. So,
so feel you free say to that use it. I can tomorrow, I can come to the office, install this package, just do command R, replace async pipe to push pipe all over my project, and nobody would notice it except like the customer who would say, "Wow, it became so faster."
Yes and no. So we did, before we started to publish the libraries, we worked a lot with companies, and those were our like greenfield experiments, how to introduce that stuff, what are problems, how can you migrate your application to such thing. And pretty much everything works. There are a couple of things related to projected views. So change detection in Angular has a tiny, tiny edge case where projected views are not following the hierarchical order and so on. Low level detail. So if you replace everything with the push pipe and something is not working, you just switch the particular push pipe to the native strategy, which is what Angular would do natively. Then you have the async pipe on this very place. Or you use MarkDirty. Global strategy, which is under the hood using MarkDirty. So you can just switch the strategy at places where it does not get that faster, or it does not work.
Okay.
But the
I would
push
do this
pipe
very
is,
carefully.
You should, you can just find and replace. It will mostly work everywhere.
But what are the like common places where it can be broken? Like maybe there are already, you know, like don't do this in components with that, that, or that.
Yeah, so if you sometimes, especially when you use overlays and this stuff, your structure is relying on top-down rendering. So you trigger a button and then the layover, the overlay of the page should pop up, and this is triggered by going from top to bottom. In these cases, you just need to specifically trigger the overlay component, and it would also work. We did not encounter any situation not solvable so far. Routing is interesting. You will have some problems with routing. At the moment, we fix this by just listening to the router events and re-rendering when the routing navigation end event fired. But yeah, nearly everything is solvable. But before I encourage you to replace the ngif hack with the async pipe, the ngif hack with the push pipe, I would encourage you to replace it with the rxlet directive. Because with structural directives, as I demonstrated before, you can get even more performance. The push pipe lives on the component level, and you can re-render the full component. But the structural directives encapsulates a very tiny piece of template inside your component and only treats this very component and re-renders this very component snippet and not the full component.
Cool stuff. Yeah. Okay, you promised to release the project soon, like in your last words in your talk was like you promised, but do you have like more wider roadmap for the project for the future? Like you're going to release what you have now, but do you have any other plans?
So at the moment, we are in beta 0, I guess, and this was the last release we did on NPM. And since then, the only thing that we did was researching and refactoring and getting a better understanding of what should be the internal structure look like that we can reuse as most of those building blocks across our features that we want to ship. And now we are pretty sure what to do. We will introduce those changes and then we will open up more of the public API. If we would not wait for this refactoring phase, it was like 3 months of refactoring and researching and whatever. If we did not do that, we would release the next version. We would realize that it's not perfect and we will break people. So we really try to don't break stuff too much, and therefore moving slow. We have a lot of working code. People already go to our repository, download it and use it in their applications, but we don't ship it yet in NPM. We take our time and really make it perfect.
Okay, good. And the last, like we have 3 minutes left, and the last question, like Angular is built on Zone.js, but every time I hear like how to avoid Zone.js, how to do that without Zone, like is there a at least something good in the Zone.js?
Yes. I try to get rid of it, so I read a lot of flame charts, and Zone.js gives you a very cool way of having having state across all your execution context. So Zone knows when the work is done in your application. Zone knows when a micro task is ended or when a animation frame was fired, and can then detect this and re-render it. Zone.js also helped us to basically completely forget about state management. I mean, how many Angular developers can explain to me why the page gets updated? I'm pretty sure 99.5% of all of us don't know why exactly we see the number on the screen, why we re-render our component. And this is because there is no state management, there is no re-rendering involved. It is all done under the hood because Zone.js patched the global APIs of our browser, so we don't feel it. The downside of that is if you patch global APIs, you patched global APIs, so you have to live with that, and you cannot call a set timeout without triggering Zone again, right? So this was the unpatch directive and other stuff where we tackled this problem not by running this code with zone, ng-zone run outside of Angular and still rely on this mechanism. We took the other road, pretty interesting. Zone patches all the global APIs and then it holds the original method somewhere so that you have a reference. And we just look for that reference. And if this reference is there, we know Zone was here and patched the API and we use the original reference. If the reference is not there, we just use the browser API as is because we are running in a zone-less application. So we don't care if you use Zone or not, it will always have that performance.
Okay, got you. So let's move to the discussion zone in Zoom and continue.
Let's do that.
Mikhail and Ekaterina, thanks for your talk. Let's go to discussion zone in Zoom. Bye-bye.